2 Thessalonians chapter 2. So last week, that's where we ended up. We were in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we got a good little portion of it done. But what I wanted to do was I wanted to try to finish it up tonight, and then next week I think we're going to talk about the mark of the beast. I was going to try to put all that together, and to be honest with you, I need to start practicing on shutting it down a little bit earlier, because school's starting, and I've had complaints even a long time ago. Sabrina's child corrected me and said, you know, he needs to preach less long on Thursday nights. We got school in the morning, and longer on Sunday mornings, because we want to get our snack time. Send that preacher straight. Anyway, so we're going to figure it out, amen? We will figure it out. All right, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Let's see here, where do we... Let's go to verse 3. The title of tonight's message is the Clash of the Kingdoms, because I think that's the way that the Lord led me, so we'll get to that in a moment. But we're going to review just a little bit. In verse 3 it says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed." So that day there, if you look up at verse 2, is specifically at the end there, talking about the day of Christ is at hand, the day of Christ. Paul says that on more than one occasion, and really most scholars would tell you that it's going back to the day of the Lord, the day of judgment. And so in that time frame, what we would be talking about specifically, now you remember last week, if you were here, and maybe I'll just try to help you remember, I talked about two different things. I talked about this word parousia, P-A-R-O-U-S-I-A. And that really, most scholars say that has to do specifically with the second coming of Jesus Christ. But there are some others who say that it can embody the whole event of the end. So in other words, it would also include the rapture of the church and the time frame, because you know it's going to be a process that Jesus is coming back, and so it includes both the rapture and the second coming. And I even taught it to you that last week that those two events represented bookends, right? I don't know if you remember now, but I had a slide with little bookends, and that the time frame in between was that tribulation period. Well, nevertheless, right here when it says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come," it's talking about the day of Christ. It's talking specifically about that day of judgment, all right? And so what it says right here is that two things have to take place. And we've spent a lot of time on this, but I just want to go ahead and try to remind you of it. Two things have to take place. Number one, first, a falling away. And then number two, the man of sin revealed. All right, so two things have to take place before this day, if I am correct in my interpretation of this scripture, which I believe strongly as I studied it, that this scripture is talking about the day of Christ representing that judgment day of the second coming whenever Jesus comes back. Two things have to take place: the falling away and the man of sin must be revealed. Now, can this happen simultaneously? This part right here, we didn't talk about that last week, but can the man of sin be revealed and at the same time the rapture of the church take place? Yeah, I believe that's certainly a possibility. And the way that the man of sin is revealed originally, I personally believe, is that it has to do with that Daniel 9 prophecy that we spent 3 to 4 weeks on, and we're not going back there, but we have YouTube videos up, the Daniel 9 verse 27 prophecy about the 70 weeks, and that it literally actually equated out to 490 years, and that there's a last 7-year period which begins when Antichrist confirms a covenant with many, talking about Israel. So when Antichrist signs that covenant with Israel, that begins, or it's a time clock, if you will, that initiates and starts that last 7-year period. The clock starts ticking at that point in time. That's what I mean by revealed. Amen. We'll be able to see it. I believe that. Now, I don't believe the whole church is going to be able to see it. I'm going to tell you why in a second.
But I don't believe that the whole church is going to be able to see it. But I believe that we, amen, the bride of Christ, only by the grace of God, don't let, if you're watching the video, don't think that the preacher thinks that he's something that he's not, that he ought not be. It doesn't have anything to do with him. It doesn't have anything to do with the fact that we have a sign that says Crossway Ministry on the outside. No, we haven't got the market cornered. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about we desire to be diligent. We desire to hear from the voice of the Holy Spirit. We understand that there's deception in the air, and that the enemy of our soul is trying to deceive us. And we're going to see it in this scripture right here. There's lies that are propagated from behind pulpits, and the people are blinded so oftentimes as they sit in the pew, and they can't see. Amen? So we know that deception's coming. So two things have to take place. Number one, a falling away. Number two, the man of sin must be revealed. Then that day will come. Now, what I spent a lot of time on was this concept right here, falling away. And what I told you was that in the Greek language, that word right there was apostasia. Now, you know, there's men that I greatly respect and other scholars in addition who state that this falling away would have been better translated, taken away, or whatever the case. And that the idea is descriptive of the rapture of the church. So with that translation, the idea is two things must take place. First, the rapture of the church must happen. Second, the man of sin would then be revealed before the second coming of Jesus. Well, my only thing about that is this, is that the word apostasia there has never been translated. It's only used twice in the New Testament, here and in the book of Acts. And I talked to you about that last time, and I gave you the scripture. In the book of Acts, it was referring to a time whenever the apostle Paul was coming back into town, and the other disciples or some leaders came against the apostle Paul and said, it's been said, basically, I'm paraphrasing, that you have told everyone to forsake the law of Moses. And so specifically in that particular scenario, the word forsake is connected to the word apostasia. That's the only time that that word is used twice in the New Testament. And in both of these cases, or at least in that case, is describing that you're connected to some form of doctrine and that you've turned your back on it and you've walked away. And in this particular case here, I definitely believe with all my heart that this word is speaking of an apostasy. And I went through, I had a lot of other scriptures to show you, but there was another spot too in the Septuagint, we're not going to get into all that, where this word was also used. And it was descriptive again of apostatizing from the faith. It had to do with one of the kings who had used the articles of the temple, and he had bought out another foreign king to come and help him, and basically sold out. And so it was kind of like the idea of an apostasy that's taking place. And so what I want you to know is that if the scripture is saying that there has to be first a falling away, then the idea here in what I'm saying is that you're going to see an apostasy and apostatizing from the faith that takes place before those end days happen. And I have to tell you that I believe that time frame's already on us. I believe that we're already there. You understand what I'm saying? Like, it's prevalent in the midst of the church. And there's people, the gospel's been changed. The gospel's been diluted. People aren't even preaching the cross. They aren't preaching the blood. Right. And not only that, they're not preaching against sin. Nobody wants to hear somebody tell them that they can't live their life any old way that they want to. And the fact is that no, that's not the gospel. You got to tell the whole story. We understand there ain't none of us perfect in this place, including the preacher, but that doesn't mean that we shy away from the truth. Amen? God's holy, and he desires a holy people to live for him. And the good news is that he doesn't expect you to do it in your own strength. He's never asked you to do that in your own strength. Instead, he provided a plan, the sending of his son to die on a cross, amen, to pay the penalty of your sin so that you could be connected back to the presence of God. You know, that's what the cross is all about, access. Did you know that? The cross is all about access. Access to what? Access to the power of God. Access to the presence of God. Access to the Spirit of God. What is it that ails you tonight? What is it that you struggle with? What is it that you're tormented with in your mind and in your heart? The things that the Lord's been dealing with you about. Amen? I got to tell you that the victory's been won. I said it when I prayed earlier. The problem isn't with the Lord, and the problem isn't with his word. The problem is with man. As he continues to travel his own journey in disobedience towards the things of God. Nevertheless, what I'm telling you is that there's an apostasy. And I'm telling you right now, I believe it with all my heart. The Lord put it in my heart back when I wrote that book a while back that there's even a bigger apostasy coming.
Yes,
I'm telling you that there is so much deception on the face of the earth right now, and that whenever the end really starts to show up, I don't even think people are going to be able to see it. I'm telling you, the church is so blind to the ways of the enemy and to the works of the enemy, and we have not even given him. Listen to me, I don't believe in giving the devil credit. He's a defeated foe under the foot of Jesus, but I'm here to tell you right now, we haven't given him the credit that he's due.
Right.
We're talking about we're dealing business with a fallen angel of the smartest kind.
Yes.
Yeah. He was created perfect in the ways of God. He understood. He was perfect in wisdom. And now he's a fallen creature. And if we thought that we were going to be more wise than him and not have the possibility to be deceived, then we were wrong.
Yes.
I'm telling you right now, we better hold on to the Lord, and we better get into the Word.
Yes.
So listen, I hope I'm wrong. I hope that the scripture's saying, no, the rapture's got to take place first.
Right.
Amen? And I hope that we do have a pre-tribulation rapture. You don't think I want to hang around, do you? No. But at the same time, I want to be ready for everything.
Right.
Now, you can do what you want with that.
Amen.
You can get mad at me. You can say, well, I'm going to find another church. I'm going to do this. Well, that's up to you. I don't want to run you off now. I'm not trying to get you mad. I'm not trying to step on your toes. But I'm here to tell you, I want to be prepared, amen,
yes,
for whatever comes our way. Hallelujah. And let me tell you this. Some people are like, oh, well, I'll just wait. You know, whenever that day comes, I'm going to be ready. Well, hold on a second. If you can't live for him now, how are you going to live for him then?
Mm-hmm.
You know, the truth of the matter is that the enemy of our soul, there's some power connected to sin. And we need to learn how now to hold on to Jesus.
Amen.
We need to learn now how to hold on to the Lamb of God and to receive the victory, amen, that we desire to come our way to give us victory. So it says right here, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day, that judgment day, shall not come except there come a falling away or an apostasy first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. That word revealed, I don't think that we got into it a whole lot, but maybe we did, but I don't want to pass this up. That word revealed right there is apokalupto in the Greek. Now, the only reason I point that out, I think we did talk about this, is because the word revelation for the book of Revelation is apokalupsis. You see how closely those two words are connected. And essentially what I'm trying to tell you is that everything that the enemy does is a counterfeit version of what Jesus is. Amen? He wants to counterfeit everything that God has done. So there's a Christ, there's an Antichrist. There's a revelation, there's going to be another revelation. There's an apocalypse, there's going to be an apocalypto. And he's going to have a revealing. And when he shows up, he's not coming with horns. You understand? He's coming as a man of peace. And he's going to say he has peace for the world in the midst of chaos. And already a while back, we watched that video where Greta Van Susteren was saying on Fox News, and I don't think that, you know, whatever, maybe she is part of the whole system. It wouldn't surprise me, but let's give her a break and say that she doesn't know any better. But nevertheless, what she was screaming out of her mouth was, we need one man to step up to the plate and to lead us all in the right direction. We need all nations to come together and to work together as one. I'm here to tell you that, listen, in that same night that we showed that video, after we left, we found out that ISIS had killed those Marines the same very day. And one of the comments I made when we showed that video was, wait until it starts striking the soil here in America, and then watch what Greta starts saying. You understand what I'm saying? You watch what's going to happen. The media is going to start, and people are going to start crying out for it, man. I'm telling you right now, you start putting people in a stranglehold, and you start taking their air away, and their water away, and their food away, and you back them up into a corner, you'll be surprised what people start screaming for.
Yeah, that's right.
Take our sovereignty. We'll talk about that next week. Take away our freedoms. It doesn't matter. Just protect us. Give us the Patriot Act. It doesn't matter if you got to strip me down and do a cavity search to get me on that airplane. Just protect me.
Mm-hmm.
Don't let those terrorists sit next to me. You understand what I'm saying? And listen, well, I didn't plan on talking about this, but there was something that's called the Hegelian dialect. And what the Hegelian dialect says is that you cause a chaotic event to happen. You cause a chaotic event to happen, And then what you do is that you go really, really far over this way, and then what you do is that when you see the response that people aren't quite ready for that, you just back up a little bit. But what you did was you brought them all the way from here to here. And they didn't even realize it. And they really kind of wanted it because chaos happened. You understand what I'm saying? In a certain fashion, if 9/11, and I'm just gonna say it wasn't exactly what they told us it was. They got a huge thing passed whenever they did that Patriot Act thing. And so what ends up happening, though, is that it's a chaos thing. You create chaos, and in the midst of chaos, people say, fix us, help us, take care of us, please, big brother. And it gives them an opportunity to move forward with an agenda if any of that stuff is even really true. All right. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that I believe with all of my heart that that's exactly what's been taking place. And this happens a little bit at a time. Oh, it's ramped up now. It's moving along faster than you can hardly blink your eyes. But for the longest time, it was just moving along so slowly that you could barely see it. As a matter of fact, one of the mottos of the Illuminati, if you believe that that could even exist, is order through chaos. That's what they say. We're going to bring order through chaos. So what I'm trying to tell you is, in the way that I'm connecting that to what I'm talking about, is that a greater apostasy is even on the front end.
Yeah.
It looms ahead. That whenever the deception strikes, whenever the chaos hits, and if things are unfolded that could be unfolded, and it begins to shake people's core. I'm trying to tell you that when I started to research some of the stuff in the occult that I researched, it started to cause my ground to shift a little bit. I'm just being honest with you. I started questioning things. I started, I'm like, what in the world is this? I never knew this. And it started causing my liver to quiver. But you know what ended up happening was is that the Lord said, hold on a second, son. You thought that that beast was something that was just going to show up at the very end? No! He's been over here waving his little clawed fingers from the get-go. He's been here from the beginning. This beast has been galloping through the annals of human history, destroying my people. Yeah. He doesn't just show up at the end. He's been here. He's a deceiver. He's a liar. He's got blinders on the people's eyes and they cannot see. The Lord spoke to my spirit. He said, you need to calm down. I'm still in control. Yeah. No matter what you find, no matter what you see, I'm in control.
Yeah, thank you, Lord.
You just got to learn how to hold on to me, son.
Thank you, Lord.
The same grace that was with the Apostle Paul and with Peter is with you.
Yes.
No matter what you have to face,
that's right.
No matter what you have to go through, supernatural grace, power from the Holy Ghost to get you through. Amen? Hallelujah.
Yes, He will.
He wants you to be with Him.
Yes.
That's good news. Amen? He's not trying to get rid of us. I used to think that. I know I need to get on with my message, but I used to think that. Every time I messed up, I felt like God was wanting to kick me out. And the truth of the matter is, one day I got a revelation. He wants me to be with Him.
Yes. Right.
He did all that. He sent His Son to die on a cross because He wants me to be with Him.
Amen.
He wants me in relationship. He's not looking for a reason. Brother Larson used to say He's not looking for a reason to kick you out. He's looking for a reason to bring you in, to keep you in. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. He knows we're fallen creatures. Doesn't make it okay that we keep on living any old way we want to. But He wants us to be with Him.
Yes.
Amen. He's proven Himself.
He's created Himself.
Thank you, Jesus, for relationship, for love. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
All right. Verse 4. Who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God. This is verse 4 of 2 Thessalonians 2. Or that is worshipped, so that he is God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. And we went through the whole process. We talked about the fact that Daniel mentioned this, but not only Daniel. And it was partially fulfilled during that time. I'm not going to get into all that. But then Jesus said it in Matthew 24. He told us that the day is coming. He said, when you see the abomination that causes desolation that Daniel the prophet spoke of, run to the hills. Mm-hmm. He was talking about this, the Antichrist, who sits himself in a wing of the temple and he exalts himself and he says, hey, I'm God. This is going to be at the mid-tribulation point right here. This is definitely a mid-trib situation right here where it's, and the reason I say that, going back to the Daniel 9 prophecy, In the Daniel 9 prophecy, it says he, the Antichrist, will confirm a covenant with many, talking about Israel. And in the middle of the week, that week was a 7-year period. In the middle of it is 3.5 years. He will break that covenant. He will cause the sacrifices to cease. This is a mid-trib point. This is when he really reveals himself for who he really is. Amen? And so what ends up happening. Now I do want to tell you that I thought that this was interesting. And I don't agree with this viewpoint. But I thought it was interesting enough at least to mention it. Because once again, I'm trying to wrap my mind around every possible scenario. And I'm throwing them out there to y'all. Not to get you aggravated with me and say, oh, he doesn't even believe in the blessed hope. No. Not because I want to prepare you to think about some of these things. And one of the things that this, and now he doesn't even believe in a rapture. Or he believes in a post-tribulation rapture. There's some smart people out there that believe that kind of stuff, by the way. I just want you to know that. And anyway, this man believes that it won't even be a rebuilt temple. I don't believe that. I believe that there will be a physical temple rebuilt. But he quotes all the scriptures in the New Testament about the fact that you've become the temple of God. Mm. You're the temple. He said, and one of the things that he talked about was is that the people of God, under great deception and under the counterfeit church, who has been blinded by this apostasia that's taking place right now as we see it, end up allowing the Antichrist and the Antichrist system and Satan to sit on the throne of their heart where the temple of God is located. So that's his perception of it. I thought it was interesting enough at least to mention it. Once again, I don't believe that. I believe that there will be a physical temple in which he will exalt himself as God. But I just wanted to bring that out to you. And it goes on to say in verse 5, remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things. And now ye know that withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. I don't know if you remember or not, but I told you that the word withholdeth and the word letteth both meant the same thing. And y'all probably don't remember what it was. Who said that?
I did.
What, you?
Yeah.
Awesome.
That's a problem.
No. I just want to make sure I had the right problem. Withholdeth and letteth means restraint. Restrained. So what is the idea there? Is that there's a force that's restraining the revelation of this man of sin. There's a force that's restraining his coming forth. I thought it was interesting because one of the persons that does study some of this occultic stuff also, I say occultic stuff, you understand, the history of the occult, the forces of evil and what their plans could be. We're not over there doing seances and learning black magic, okay? But people that are aware of this, one of the people that realize that the enemy has a plan. You see, because before I started looking into any of this, I just thought everything was haphazard and disorganized. But that was what started freaking me out, was when I realized how organized everything was.
Amen.
You understand what I'm getting at? And one of these people said, made the comment, they said, well, why doesn't it just happen then? They've been trying all this time. Well, they can't just do whatever they want to do. He that withholdeth, he that letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. Until the Holy Spirit is removed from restraining that man of sin, he will continue to be held down. He will continue to be restrained. But when the time is right and the Holy Spirit backs off of this situation, that doesn't necessarily mean that the Holy Spirit's not going to be here during the Great Tribulation, because then that would mean that people couldn't get saved.
That's right.
All right, and we don't need to get into that too deep, but nevertheless, I will say this. I believe that people are going to still get saved. Yeah. The only people that can't get saved, and we'll talk about that next week, are the people that take the mark. And for you not to be able to get saved after you take the mark, that means something's got to happen to you. Something, and it's more than just pledging allegiance to the enemy, because you will have to pledge allegiance to the enemy in order to be able to engage in that system. But it's got to be something bigger than that. In some way, shape, or form, when you pledge allegiance to that enemy, something's got to happen to you. I believe maybe something through that mark. I don't know. I can't prove it. But something about taking that mark is going to change something in your neurology.
Yeah, yeah.
Listen to me. Satanists that give their heart to the enemy in order to gain power and greed have been convicted by the power of the Holy Spirit and have fallen on their knees and given their life to Jesus, and the Lord still shows up and saves them from their sin. Amen. And gives them new hope and a new life.
Amen.
Yeah. He can do that today. If a Satanist would hear the truth and give his heart to Jesus.
Yeah. That's right.
Something's happening, though, to these people that are taking the mark.
That's right.
And they're not able to go back.
That's right.
And so, all I can say is that help us, Lord. Yes. Amen. And help the people that love you not to be deceived.
Yes.
So there's going to be a day when the Holy Spirit is going to be removed and He will be revealed. He's going to have His own revelation. That's what it says in verse 8. And then, whenever the Holy Spirit moves out the way, the restraining force is moved out the way in that situation, and then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of His mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of His coming. Once again, that word apocalypto is there, and that's the enemy. I'm telling you, He's going to counterfeit it. And listen, He's going to come. I believe He's going to come with splendor. I'm telling you, look, Jesus is coming with splendor. All eyes are going to see Him when He shows up for that second coming. And I'm telling you right now, the enemy of our soul, I'm telling you, he's going to come with splendor. God help us, help the people and inhabitants on the earth, because you don't even know what they got planned. You don't even know the technology that people have out there and the things that they can do and the way that they can manipulate things and cause figments of your imagination. And we'll talk a little bit about that next week. But I'm telling you right now, there's some things that people, listen to me. You think that they're telling us everything that they know how to do? Come on, somebody.
No.
I'm telling you right now, man. They got, listen, the Germans, I shouldn't get into all this. The Germans, back in World War II, with Wernher von Braun and this guy Joseph Mengele, who was a psychiatrist at Auschwitz, they learned how to split people's personalities off just by causing pain in them. And then they'd work with each little personality, and they literally brainwash people into being able to put them in deep hypnosis, and they'd be able to say a certain thing to them, and they'd be able to turn them on. And they'd be able to, and they'd tell them, you go do this, and they would go and do an assignment and come back and never remember a thing. Now, that was back in the 40s. And now, God help us, because we don't even know the things that they can do. And so all I'm trying to tell you is that, and listen, that's common knowledge. Jesse Ventura did a show on that where he went and talked to the CIA guy. They said that on TV. And so I'm telling you, there's a whole lot more going on. Anyway, the point is that there's some deception on the way. And he's coming, and he's going to have a counterfeit appearance. And but where it says right there that the Lord shall consume in verse 8 with the spirit of His mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of His coming, that's talking about the Battle of Armageddon. That's a reference to that. And if you would go with me to Revelation chapter 12, I just want to read some scripture to you. And I want to kind of go through a couple of scriptures related to that concept of the Battle of Armageddon, but also using chapter 12 of the book of Revelation as a reference point to kind of talk about some of those thoughts. Now, when I said the clash of the kingdoms, what I want you to know is that this war has been going on for thousands of years. Amen? And so it says right here in chapter 12, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven. Now, the idea behind the word wonder is literally a sign, a marvel. It's something that theoretically it can be seen. Now, I have to tell you that there's a lot of people that claim that there's going to be a movement of certain constellations that are going to, this is above my pay grade, but I'm just telling you, a movement of certain constellations that represent various things, like the king planet and a certain constellation called Regulus, which is the king constellation, and Virgo having to do with the Virgin, and all of these various things, and that all this stuff's going to show up in the sky. To be honest with you, it wouldn't surprise me that God could allow things such as this to be played off on the backdrop of the sky, that He's the creator. Some people would say, well, why would you talk about the zodiac constellations whenever you know good and well that Nimrod turned that stuff into black magic? Well, hold on a second. God created them. God created the constellations, and I'll tell you something else that's in the Bible. Well, let me show you what I'm talking about. Let me see if I can find it. Job. If you want to turn with me to Job chapter 38, verse 32. You see on my screen what I got right there? You see that word Maseroth right there in verse 32? I got a Strong's Greek dictionary built into my phone. Y'all know what that is? It's got the Hebrew and the Greek in it. when I press on Mazaroff, this is what it says about that. The 12 signs of the zodiac and their 36 associated constellations. Wow. Job talked about Mazaroth in the book. God created the constellations. Now, this is the thing. Don't ever be confused. Nimrod perverted it. And he turned it into black magic and he turned it into occultic worship. At the same time, what I'm trying to say is that, yes, there's the possibility, and that's not even what I'm trying to preach here, the possibility that this wonder could be in the sky. But what I want to do is I want to go a little bit deeper than that, and I want to look at the story behind it. And I want us to follow, what would this sign in the heavens, if these constellations really did line up, what would they literally be showing anyway to begin with, and why? What's the story about it? It says, there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. Now, if you go back and you realize 12 stars are representative of the 12 tribes of Israel, and if you realize that in Joseph's dream that the sun and the moon represented Sarah and Abraham, and you go on through the story, and it goes on to say, and she being with child, who's she? Not Mary, not the Mary of the Catholic Church, no, but instead Israel. Israel as a woman. Amen. That God, the womb that God used, prepared, and created in order to give birth. Yes, Mary was a part of that plan, and we're not trying to take anything away from her. But what this is talking about is the woman Israel, clothed with 12 stars, the 12 tribes of Israel. And here she is. She's being with child and cried and travailing in birth and pain to be delivered. Now, I got to tell you right now that that's a fulfillment of Isaiah chapter 7. Well, let's keep reading, and then we're going to go back to Isaiah. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven. This is where we get the concept that Satan took a third of the angels with him in his rebellion. It says, and the dragon stood before the woman which was ready to be delivered and for to devour her child as soon as it was born. So this is I believe this is a mid-tribulation sign that's taking place, and that this is something that's taking place in the heavenly realm. You understand what I'm saying? As a matter of fact, in chapter 12, as we're reading this, this is something that's taking place in the spiritual realm, in the heavenly realm. There's a war that's about to be engaged in the heavenly realm. We're going to read it. But listen, what we're going to see whenever this war is engaged in the heavenly realm, that Satan is kicked out of heaven and he comes down to the earth. And now the war is moved from there down to here. And so what happens first in the spiritual realm or the heavenly is then going to come to the earth. And now persecution, more so than ever before, is going to hit the earth. And that's, once again, I believe this is a mid-tribulation sign that's taking place. But the story itself is taking place, and it's showing us the whole story of God. You understand that? Here's the woman, and she's Israel, and she's travailing in birth. Listen, birth for a normal woman is 9 months. In other words, she's pregnant for 9 months, and then she goes through labor for a short period of time. This travailing in birth for Israel, for God's plan, has been for thousands of years. God created this woman Israel, and through her gave us Messiah. And all along the way, there's been pain. There's been pain in the midst of the pregnancy. There's been pain in the midst of the childbirth. There's been pain through it all, a travailing, because there's been a war. There's a clash of the kingdoms that's taking place. And the enemy knows that God has a plan. And every step of the way, he's tried to come against God's plan. He's tried to thwart God's plan. And he's tried to confuse it. And he's tried to sow seeds of doubt inside of God's people and destroy them with sin, even as he did with Israel, to get them off track and to get them off path. And this is what it's saying, that it says, and his tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And she brought forth the man child, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God, and they should feed her there 1,260 days. That's another 3.5 years. And there was war in heaven. See, this is where it's going on, the war in heaven. Michael, the angel Michael, and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil. And Satan, which deceiveth the whole world, he was cast out into the earth. And his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. Now I want you to see that. This is a special day in the heavenly realm. They're about to break out in song. They're breaking out in song and in jubilation or whatever the case. They're about to have, it's about to go. They're excited. And let me tell you why. Because now the kingdom of God is about to be established. This is the first, not the first step, but this is the next big step, if you will. Moving, God moving towards taking this earth back for the way that it was originally intended to be. Do you understand that? Do you understand that in the beginning, God gave dominion to Adam? And that when Adam went the way of the serpent, he relinquished his power and dominion to the serpent. And do you realize that from that day moving forward, God had initiated a plan wherewith he would bring not only salvation to mankind, but where his Christ would rule and reign on a throne on this earth, and that all of the nations of the earth would pay tribute to the nation that he had created. And what I'm trying to tell you is that every step of the way, from the calling of Abraham to the creation of the nation to the giving birth of Messiah and all those points in between, and now through the 2,000 years of the church age, and now in this spiritual battle that's taking place, there's coming a time where the enemy will be cast out of heaven, the accuser of the brethren, and he will fall upon the earth. And he, whenever he does that, that's one step closer, amen, to Jesus reaping this earth and ruling and reigning on this earth as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Yes, we understand that God is sovereign. Have you ever thought, why doesn't God just speak evil out of existence? Why doesn't God just get rid of sin? Well, that's not how God works. God has a plan. God has a purpose. Sometimes we can't understand it all completely. His ways are beyond our ways. Amen?
Amen.
And part of the reason I believe this is because he wanted you and I to engage the battle.
Yeah.
He wanted you and I. You know, there's nothing worse than being on a football team. And if you sat on the bench, I'm sorry. I'm not trying to give you a hard time. There's nothing worse than being on a football team and sitting on the bench. If you're not in the game, as far as I'm concerned, it's just not even, it's not really worth it. It's not fun. All right. And what I'm trying to say is that God wants us to be in there. He wants us to be able to be participants in what it is that he's doing. He's using us, amen, as vessels through which he would move and operate. And he's allowed all of this to stay the way that he has. But at this point, the enemy of our soul is going to be cast out. And it says right here, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and the strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. And when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle. All right, now I wanted to just show you in this story, in the heavens of what we see this woman that has a child. And she's in travail to give birth to it. And I told you that this is representative of Israel giving birth to Messiah and the ages that are taking place in the midst of it all. And that when it's all said and done, that there's a war that takes place, and that the casting out of Satan brings us one step closer to Jesus taking his rightful place on the throne to rule in Israel. I just wanted to go real quick to Isaiah chapter 7. And I wanted to show you that there's a progression in Isaiah 7, 9, and 11 that kind of tell the same story. It's just like what ended up being told right there, everything just happened all kind of at once in one short chapter. But in Isaiah, 600 years before Jesus was born, it was given to us in pieces, amen, through the prophet. And it says right here in Isaiah 7:14, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Now, the Matthew, in his gospel, he interprets that scripture for us, and he says that Emmanuel means God with us. The presence of God now coming to earth in the form of Jesus and dwelling with mankind. What I'm trying to tell you is that this Isaiah 7:14 prophecy is the same thing as this Revelation 12 sign where this woman is with child and ready to give birth. Amen? And it says here in Isaiah chapter 9, it says the same thing. For unto us a child is born, Isaiah 9 verse 6, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Once again, what does this talk about? It talks about his first advent, his birth. Whenever I say that word advent, if I say his first advent, I'm talking about the first time he showed up. I'm talking about his birth, okay? If I say his second advent, then I'm talking about his second coming. Not the rapture, but the second time he comes back in order to judge. He came the first time a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. He came the first time riding lowly on a donkey. The second time he comes back, he's coming as a judge. He's going to have a sword protruding out of his mouth. He's going to be riding a white stallion. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he's coming back to judge the nations, okay? And so what I want you to know is that the first advent is the birth. And that's what it's talking about in verse 6. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. But then in the next clause of the sentence, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Look at verse 7. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it, judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. So from that second part of that clause where it says, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, where it says the government will be on his shoulders, that's talking about the second time when he's coming back. Amen? That he's going to be the ruler. Amen? He's going to be the King of Kings, and he's going to rule and reign upon the earth. And you know, there's so much prophecy that's taking place, even in verse 7 when it says, upon the throne of David. That's a fulfillment of another prophecy out of 2 Samuel chapter 7. That God promised David that when he fell asleep with his fathers, that God would set up the throne of David, an eternal throne, that would never fade away. Amen? And that's talking about Jesus, because he came from David's lineage. He came from the tribe of Judah, and all of those promises point back to Jesus. Amen? And so it says right here, I wanted you to see that part right there, though. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. God's the one that's performing this great plan. This beautiful sign that we see in Revelation 12 of this woman that's with child and travailing to give birth. And this war. I mean, can you think of that? I mean, just think about this for a second. Let's slow down. A babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. A king that rides into town on a donkey. A king that was born in straw amongst animal manure. A dragon in the sky with seven heads and 10 crowns. I mean, seven heads and seven crowns, or whatever the case at that point in time. Because it changes. Against a baby. Against a woman who's crying in pain and giving birth to a baby. A baby versus a dragon. That's why people can't get it. That's why people miss it. That's why God chose to do it that way. Sir, ma'am, you who refuse to believe God, he wants to use the fool. He confounds the wisdom of man. Amen? And that this is what God does. And I'm so grateful that he does it that way. The power is in him. That's what it says in this verse right here. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Man's not going to perform this plan. What is it that you need in your life tonight? What is it that you're struggling with and that you've been trying to pick up with the works of your own hands in order to get freedom with? No! Yeah. You need the zeal of the Lord of hosts to work in the midst of this situation. Amen? You need God and his plan
to bring deliverance to you. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes. You can't do it in your own strength. The Lord sent a word into Jacob and it had alighted upon Israel. And all the people shall know, even Ephraim. What is Ephraim? You remember how I told you a while back that Ephraim oftentimes represents the whole northern kingdom, the whole 10 tribes, because of their idolatry and how the northern part of Israel went after false gods. That's what it's talking about right there. And the inhabitants of Samaria, that's where they had the false altar. That's where they had the altar. And they worshiped Baal. And they had the golden... Jeroboam made another altar in Samaria so that the people wouldn't go to Jerusalem to worship the Lord. It goes on to say that they say in the pride and stoutness of their heart. Look at this verse 10. The bricks are fallen down, but we will build with hewn stones. The sycamores are cut down, but we will change them into cedars. I mean, there's a whole lot that can be said about that. But what's happening right here in this verse is that God is judging Israel for her idolatry. And what he says, what they're saying is, the bricks are falling down, but we will build with hewn stones. All right? And what's interesting is that I did a little bit of research today, and I really didn't have the time. So if you find out that I wasn't right on this, then you just let me know. Tom Daschle quoted this scripture the day after 9/11 from what all I could tell. I mean, I was Googling stuff and finding it on the way over here. He quoted this the day after 9/11. Number one, he didn't realize what he was really doing, that this was a scripture that related to judgment. Let me ask you a question. Do you think that those guys write their own speeches? I can tell you right now, they don't write their own speeches. They have expert writers that write speeches for them because they're on national TV. And these people are the most brilliant people that there are. I have a hard time believing that they didn't know what that scripture is. Mm-hmm. I just don't believe it. Maybe you say I'm a naysayer and that I don't believe anything. Well, that's fine. But knowing what I know now, it wouldn't surprise me if that wasn't a purposeful move. So basically what's happening is in this case, is that Israel's being judged, but Israel says, we will rebuild and we will rebuild with hewn stones. What is a hewn stone? Well, that's, you put a tool on it. You took a chisel and a tool and you went to work on the stone and you made it look real pretty, just the way that you want it. Well, see, God's got a problem with that. I got a couple of scriptures here. Isaiah 9:7 of the increase, we already talked about that. But I wanted to tell you that the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this versus the bricks are falling down, but we will rebuild with hewn stones. In other words, man is putting his hand on it. This is what God thought about that in Exodus. Now, I don't want to lead you down the wrong way, so give me some time to work with this. If you will make me an altar of stone, you shall not build it of hewn stone, for if you lift up your tool upon it, you have polluted it. In other words, now this is an altar. So I don't want you to get confused, because in one spot we're talking about an altar, and the other spot we're talking about brick walls falling and then them rebuilding them. Nevertheless, you see what God says about man putting his hand in his plan of redemption. He says, whenever you're going to build an altar, you don't build it with hewn stones. In other words, stones that you took a tool to it, because if you put your hand on it or in the midst of it, then you've polluted it. And the point that I'm trying to make is this, is that when judgment struck Israel right there, they said, oh no, we're going to rebuild. And not only are we going to rebuild, but we're going to rebuild with the strength of our own hands. We're going to rebuild with hewn stones. We're going to put our hands on it and we're going to shape it and form it and fashion it. And many scholars will tell you that it literally means it's going to come back stronger than the way that it was before. You can try to knock it down, Lord, but we're going to come back stronger than the way that it was before. So to me, it was kind of interesting to know that Tom Daschle said that. But then also, this was something that was kind of interesting. It says, we remember, we rebuild, and we come back stronger. Like I told you, and I looked it up, that one of the scholars that I had in my app, hewn stone literally meant that they said that they were going to come back stronger, more powerful, even in the face of God's judgment. This was something that Barack Obama signed on a beam over there at 9/11 site, saying this, and kind of basically repeating, it seems like, what Tom Daschle said the day afterwards. That we're going to rebuild and we're going to come back even stronger. Once again, the idea is that judgment has stricken, but yet we're going to shake our fist in the face of it and we're going to come back even stronger. That's what the idea seems to be. All right. And so anyway, that'll be next week right there. But let's go ahead and go to verse chapter 11. of Isaiah. It says, chapter 11, verse 4. Well, let's start at verse 1. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse. You know who Jesse is? Jesse is David's daddy. Amen? Jesse was King David's daddy. And a branch shall grow out of his roots. So that's talking about King David. And then ultimately talking about the branch that comes out of the roots is talking about Jesus. Amen? Because Jesus, once again, comes from the tribe of Judah and from the lineage of King David's family. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth, and he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth. You see how this terminology, we started off in 2 Thessalonians 2 and it talked about the rod of his mouth. And it talks about smiting the nations. And this terminology is used time and again. Verse 5, and righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins and faithfulness the girdle of his reins. Now this is what I wanted you to see. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb and the leopard shall lie down with the kid. Now a kid is a baby goat. And the calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. This is talking about the millennial reign of Christ. Mm-hmm. And the point that I wanted to make with this is that we have a clash of the kingdoms taking place. And ultimately, whenever this Antichrist is going to be revealed, he's going to be promising peace. And the kind of peace that he's going to be promising is he's going to try to get all of humanity to come together. He's going to say, let's put away religious bigotry. And let's say that, you know what, we can all coexist. Muslim with Buddhist, with Christian. It doesn't matter. We tear down denominational walls. We all come together and that this is what peace looks like. But what I want you to see is what true peace looks like. When the true spirit of Christ shows up upon the earth, it says that the whole earth is going to be full of the knowledge of the Lord. And whenever that happens, the Word of God says that a wolf and a lamb are going to be able to lie together.
Yes.
The Bible says that a baby will be able to put their hand over an adder or an asp or a viper's hole. And what I'm trying to tell you, because the whole earth will be filled with his knowledge. Mankind can't chisel enough on a stone to make that happen. Mankind can't come up with that kind of peace. You understand what I'm saying? God had a plan from the beginning and it was a plan of peace. But what we're seeing is that whenever the true Christ shows up, hallelujah, that peace that surpasses all understanding is going to be with us. Amen. Romans chapter 8 verse 18 and then I'm going to close. I had some other scripture, but we're going to close with Romans 8 verse 18. In this little passage of scripture that we're going to read. Romans chapter 8 verse 18. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Sometimes you feel like you're suffering. Sometimes you feel like you're going through some things. There's struggle. Some people say the struggle is real. You're feeling pressured and pressed. The Apostle Paul wants to encourage you. He wants to tell you, he wants to say that the afflictions or the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waits for the manifestation of the sons of God. God has a plan. Listen, God created man in his own image and likeness. And we're going to see in this scripture that when man fell, that the creation fell with him. And that the entire creation is waiting and longing for the day that the enemy is cast out, that the accuser of the brethren is cast out, because it's one step closer to the final clash of the kingdoms. It's one step closer to the true Christ, amen, showing up and ruling and reigning on the earth. It says, for the creature, verse 20, was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who had subjected the same in hope. That means the creature, the creation, was brought low, was made a place of emptiness.
because of what had taken place. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. So not only will you and I receive a glorified body, but this earth is going to receive a glorified body. Amen? Listen, the reason I can't help myself but think about this, the things that the bird sings about in the morning time is that he's longing for the return of the king. I'm telling you, that's what he's singing. You don't have to believe if you don't want. That's what the bird's singing about. He's longing for the return of the king. There's going to be a day whenever the people from Pierre Port are driving and they turn off their boat that they won't hear the crash of a rotten limb fall into the water. Corruption's going to be over. Decay is going to be over because the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and the Prince of Peace is going to show back up on this earth, and things are going to be made right, and the wolf is going to lie with the lamb, amen, and hallelujah, there's going to be true peace to be found, and the creation groans and longs and waits for the redemption of the sons of men, for we know that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now, and not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. Do you have the first fruits of the Spirit, Christian?
Yes.
What does that mean? It means you got saved and the Holy Ghost lives in your heart.
Thank you, Lord.
If you got saved and the Holy Spirit lives in your heart, then you got the first fruits of the Spirit. Amen? The next fruits is when you get your glorified body. Amen? It says right here, first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves, groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption. To wit, the redemption of our body. The world, the creation, the earth is longing for the day when it will be redeemed and it will get its new body, if you will, a new heavens and a new earth, just as you and I long for the day, amen, when we will receive our glorified body. And whenever this journey is going to be over, I don't know about you, but I'm ready, Lord, make me ready to see your face, amen. Yes. Come back quickly, Lord.